Welcome to the Starfish Storytellers, the podcast that makes a difference one story at a time by bringing storytelling to life.
And I guess if I had to sum up my story in like a sentence, right, I would say delayed growth due to childhood trauma. And so I grew up in the Boston area. I live here in Michigan these days, and I work for a major university here and everything. And I moved here about 8 years ago, but I grew up in Boston, and I grew up in an alcoholic and violent home, and there was violence, there was abuse, you know, and so I had a lot of childhood trauma that I carried with me into my adulthood that I never really dealt with. And then in my early 30s, I found my way into a 12-step program. Doesn't matter which one it is, they're all great. And I will say it was really useful, and the experience for me was life-changing. And because it was the first time I actually dealt with the trauma and walked through a lot of that and unfolded it. And it helped me get unstuck. And so, you know, and it propelled me and helped me to grow. And so, you know, it was an interesting time, because it was a time when, you know, I'm learning about what color do I really like, or what's my favorite music, and what movies do I like, and what do I like to read, and things like that. And then the sexuality piece came out quite naturally. So it's sort of like, it was like I was coming to a whole of me, and then that just evolved, and it was like, oh, okay, you know. And it was really subtle. It was really subtle how it happened. And so my story on how that happened for me, and I know with other people it's really different. So I've been married now. I've been with my wife now for 17 years. It's amazing. And we've been married since just prior to coming to Michigan. And but I know for her, she knew at a very early age, and so she was just more self-aware. She had a very different childhood than me, and but she has a lot of trauma and baggage as a result of that knowing and having to keep herself hidden. And I didn't have any of that, because I had the other trauma to deal with, you know. So for me, it was when I started to evolve and to come into myself, this last piece came quite naturally. I had gone to dinner with a friend, and this is somebody that I didn't hang out with a lot, and I thought, oh, they seem really cool. I like their vibe and their energy. And then we went to dinner, and it was easy conversation, and just we had a lot of fun, a lot of laughs. And then we had met up, and then drove together to the restaurant, and then dropped her back off to get to her car, that then drive home. And I gave her a hug, and at the time I was like, I realized I wanted to kiss her, and I thought, oh, what's this about? You know, it was something something new, and I was like, huh. And so I kind of put that thought aside, like, because I was really good at, from traumatic situations, as being able to like put things in little boxes and sort of like tuck it aside. And I thought, oh, let's not go there. In fact, I went home and I set up a date immediately with a man on match.com. And so this was midweek, and then when Saturday I go on this date, and you know, the entire time I'm on the date, I'm thinking about her, and I also knew he was kind of short, and I think I deliberately and subconsciously wore really tall boots that day to the date. And so I felt like I was, like, you know, towering over him, and I was thinking about her the whole time. And I thought, you know, I had about an evening of a hissy fit, and trying to like say, oh, I don't want to deal with this, and da da da. And then and the next day I woke up, and I thought, you know what, I think I want to explore these feelings and just to see what they're about. And I'm really fortunate that I was surrounded by so many good people to reach out to. And so, and you know, there were definitely people that didn't have that sort of like all welcoming reaction, but the number of people that did far outweighed that. My brothers were really incredibly loving and supportive, and that actually surprised me, but shouldn't have. I mean, we grew up with our aunt who was gay, like, so there was knowledge there. My friends were more often than not welcoming. I did have some friends that had, you know, kind of a pullback from the situation, I think, because, you know, people are processing their own stuff. I mean, it's just, it's a lot for people to take in. I mean, I think it's no different than, you know, like if you go into, say, you all of a sudden go in and become a nun or something like that. Like, you know, it's like a whole different piece of you that they never saw coming. And so it's as much of a shock as it could be to you, it could be to them. And so I kind of had the hindsight about that too. And I was okay with that. I figured, you know what, people will come to their own evolution on things, and it's not up to me to control. And so, you know, I did have somebody that when I told them, they said, well, you know, Danny, that's not you, that's not natural. And my whole stomach did a flip-flop. And for a second, I like hesitated, but like the doors, not only were the windows open, the doors were open at, by that point. Like it was like that piece of me was coming out no matter what. And so it was like a whole coming to and not a coming out. So I called up a friend of mine initially who was gay after I had my hissy fit. And I said to them and explained what was going on. And she said, well, good for you. You know, great, good for you for acknowledging the feelings. You may be gay, you may be bi. You know, you may just be really attracted in something within this person. That you find attractive in them, you know, some part of their personality, but for, good for you for acknowledging the feelings. I'm really proud of you, you know. And so that bit of encouragement helped me to then reach out to other friends. And I just knew I wanted to be like open about all of me. I had like all of me in a closet for so long, you know, like I had to be open. And you know, no matter what the consequences were to relationships or other things. And so I reached out to friends, a close friend of mine in Canada said, oh my God, I'm so happy you finally realized. And so, so that was kind of the reaction I got from most people. Not so much from my mother. And that's surprising because my mom grew up with her sister who was gay, and they lived upstairs from us in a triple decker. For quite some time when I lived in Boston. And so, you know, mom's reaction was, how can you go from, you know, being with a man to being with a woman? And what does that mean for children, for home? And, you know, and I'm like, you know, mom, I think it's the picture's just different. You know, I said, you can still have the kids, the relationship, the white picket fence. You know, it's just a different picture. And eventually, like, I let it go. And my mom and I weren't wholly intimate, like into having like that kind of dialogue and discussion. So I knew well enough to let mom process it. And I think my aunt was an ally in that process for her too. And my brothers certainly had something to say about it. And they were awesome. And then from there, I think my aunt wanted to be more of a support for me. So my first year in coming aware was more, it wasn't just coming out, it was being aware first, and then and accepting that, and then exploring it. And then you know, and my aunt wanted to be like there for me, and she mentioned it, and we talked about it. And but I didn't really need it, you know. For me, my story is one of just it's not so much just coming out. Like I came out and I stayed out. And if I had to say, that would be my story.
Hello, my name is Liana Henry, and welcome to the Starfish Storytellers. I'm the CEO of the Black Dog Group, a Marcom and project management firm headquartered on the east coast of the U.S. in quaint colonial Bedford, Massachusetts. I'm your host and passionate about storytelling. I'm actually on a mission to raise up the next generation of storytellers. We've named ourselves the Starfish Storytellers after the starfish story. The moral of the starfish story is based on the power of one. No matter how big the challenge, each action we take makes a difference and has an impact. One step, one starfish, or one story at a time. Every episode, we welcome a new storyteller who will share their story meant to inspire and connect with you. Then we'll break it down and offer tips for any listeners who are ready to tell their own stories. So thanks for tuning in. Now let's get started. Today's episode is in honor of Pride Month 2024, and with me today is my dear friend Danielle Smith. In addition to being a research administrator for life sciences at a large university in Michigan, she is a proud fur mama, musician, talented photographer, and member of the LGBTQ plus community. Danielle is joining me today to share her journey and some insights she learned along the way. So thank you so much for being here. We're really excited to have you.
Thank you very much for having me. It's an honor.
We'd like to get started by having our guests introduce themselves. And you do a much better job than I did. So would you mind telling folks a little bit more about you?
Sure. So I currently live in Michigan. I grew up in the Boston area. And I work for University of Michigan, which I'm proud to share. They do a lot of DEI initiatives, and I'm very proud to represent. I don't represent UMM. I represent myself here on this podcast today. But I'm very proud to be working at University of Michigan. And in the role that I am in at the Institute in particular, who are very strong allies in the movement. So
nice. So I loved hearing your story. I've known you for a long time. I have never heard it in its totality. I love the concept of coming aware before coming out. I can only compare it to the, you know, queer folks in my family, but, you know, for some folks, it was sort of just a natural evolution that they were going to come out. And then for some folks, there was sort of this urgency that they needed to tell their story. And so there was this coming out, you know, experience as opposed to being aware. So I really loved sort of, and I loved how you compared your wife's experience to your experience. And how that was different based on the background that you came from. You know, for us, this time of year is very, very important because on our team, we have straight allies, gay, lesbian, and pansexual folks that all work for our company. And we come to work every day of the year being our authentic selves. But for this time of year, we like to use our platforms and channels to speak out about why Pride matters and to talk a little bit about how folks could help or get help. How do you get involved with Pride?
So here in Michigan, so I moved here about 8 years ago, pre-pandemic. And so I haven't been as involved here in Michigan in Pride activities, except on campus. And, so we haven't, and my wife transitioned with the pandemic, so it wasn't like time for social activity. So we're really feeling like now we're starting to venture there. And there's a massive Pride celebration in Detroit in June. So we're trying to think about our plans around that activity. And there's a lot happening in Michigan. My wife grew up in Michigan. And so it's been interesting having her come back and have a different kind of experience than what she had during her childhood. It's much more open here. We live in Washtenaw County, which is, I'm sure, like the political spectrum has a lot to do with this. It's 95% Democrat here. And so it's a very open area, and the university has a lot to play in that role. They play a big part of that. So as far as Pride here, I wasn't heavily involved. I was more involved in Massachusetts. So we lived in Western Mass for a time. We lived in Northampton. We like to say that's the Pride capital of the world. it's at every level. And it's wonderful and such an inclusive town. Mm-hmm. And it's actually, and it's home of Smith College. So it's a reason why a lot of students choose to go to Smith, as it's a safety thing for them as well, in terms mm-hmm. of having a safe and inclusive environment as they experience that through school. Mm-hmm. But I would say it's, there are 5 colleges out there, and they're equally as inclusive and welcoming.
So, in addition to obviously the people that work together, I have family who identify as gay. And, you know, when they came out, I remember everything was like rainbows and let's get involved in Pride and let's go hang the flag, the rainbow flag. And I thought showing my support was being really open about it and out there. And, you know, I'm wearing all my rainbows, look at me. But what I learned was that being gay is only part of the human pie, just like being straight is only part of the human pie. And being white is part of the human pie, being Black, being Latino, being Indigenous, it's all part of the human pie. And, you know, some of my folks have taught me that being creative and inquisitive, maybe loving to cook, maybe being an athlete, being a loyal friend, being skilled at their jobs, being very comedic or funny, all of this goes into making them who they are. And all of that needs to be acknowledged and addressed and loved. And sexual orientation didn't need to be front and center. Now, you talked about in your story about how your family and friends responded. You know, you had family that was loving and some friends that were and some friends that weren't. For the ones that, at least for the ones that were supportive, because I think people want to be supportive, but they might not know how. Did you find that you were able or felt like you needed to kind of guide them a little bit on best ways to be supportive?
For some, it was, I think, a bit harder. I didn't have to guide them. I don't feel like it's my job to, like, guide them in that way. Like, to, people want to, I think people love you genuinely. And I think people have their own stuff that they have to guide themselves through and their own issues and biases. I will share an experience, though, I had at work. And I won't name the who, but sometimes people feel like they have to connect with you by naming, like, you know, the conversation will start off like this. So my gay neighbor or my gay friend, or, you know, it's like they feel like they want to relate to you personally, and they feel like that's the way to do it, the most personal. And it's really not. Like, there's so much more to me as a person. I'm highly creative. I sing, I do photography, I write, like, you know, there's all these things that I do. And in addition to entertaining my fur babies 24/7, who you may even hear on this call, on this recording, mm-hmm. you know, but there's so much more to me. And I'm a wife, I'm a family member, I'm a sister, there's just, and I think that, this person was definitely trying to relate to me by talking about their gay neighbor. And it just, you could tell the awkwardness on the conversation. And I would say that for folks, if you're an ally, don't relate in that way. Like, they'll eventually be comfortable enough to talk with you, and they'll see you like them as a whole person. And so people will open up about all of them, and you'll find very interesting things about people when they talk about themselves. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I've had young adults in my life feel the need to guide me, especially on things like pronouns. They got to the point with me. It was never intentional. I wasn't ever trying to be disrespectful. It was new mm-hmm. to me. But they got to the point where before they would even introduce me to somebody, they would let me know, okay, this person is non-binary. They, you know, identify as they, them. You know, don't call this person a he, don't call this person a she. So it was like they were running interference for me so that I wouldn't, like, have a giant faux pas. and harm someone or hurt or unintentionally hurt somebody.
Right. And I will tell you that even I struggled with pronouns. So, I grew up speaking English language one way, and then, you know, we've had a whole host of trainings at U of M, and which is wonderful. And so we all struggled through this process together. And, it's extra challenging. So I'm in an environment with a lot of international people. I mean, we struggle just to pronounce names, you know? And so a lot of times we will defer to someone's name before we defer to a pronoun. And that will be secondary, but many of us include our pronouns in our signature line, yeah, which is helpful to a lot of people.
Yeah.
So helps them to identify and to communicate with us.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Very important. I think I was poking around your LinkedIn because I only know you from one area of life. I didn't know you in your personal, like your professional career. And I see that you worked in higher education. Mm-hmm. So some of my questions around that were, and I think you sort of answered some of this, you know, was your sexual orientation ever an issue? If it was, how so? But if it wasn't, in what ways were employers welcoming to you? And then, you know, you have a DEI department at UMM that is very active. Mm-hmm. Have you been involved in any of their planning, programming, strategy, anything like that? Or like your department's like contributed to anything to help out? Or so I know I've asked you like 10 questions.
That's okay. So I'm going to answer the first one around I'm a research administrator. And so I've been in research administration now over 24 years. And I've worked at 5 institutions. And I will name them all proudly: Harvard, Northeastern, Smith College, UMass Amherst, and now University of Michigan, which I hope to retire at, and done moving around. And I will tell you, they were all welcoming. I'm really glad that I came aware while working in academia. It's a really healthy environment for that. And I'm really proud of the work U of M is doing in the area of DEI. They created this initiative, and it skyrocketed at the university, and it's done from the roots level. And so I actually served on the originating DEI committee where we formed the strategy for DEI at the institute. And so I was on that committee for a while, and it was very interesting, actually. I learned a lot about my own internal biases, and we had a lot of great discussions, a lot of great dialogue, trainings and other things around forming this. And our leadership is, they are allies. And so at the institute and at the university, but I will say strongly at the institute, so much so that they formed a position of DEI director, which is unusual. And so this person lives at the precipice of science and administration. Mm-hmm. And so they're able to communicate with both sides, doing a phenomenal job. And, you know, so I was very involved with that. They do a lot of initiatives and activities. It's a very inclusive environment. Like, it's almost like being in a sandbox where you get to play all the time, and you get to choose all the toys you want to play with. And that's all good. And nothing is off the table for that, which is really nice. And we really work hard to make sure it's inclusive at all levels.
I was going to ask about that because, so just in my experience dealing with DEI, because we had a DEI director or officer or someone at a tech company where I was at. And I just recently took a storytelling certification class for guided autobiography. And there were some themes that now we're tying into DEI because it's now on the forefront. People are addressing this now where they didn't address it before. Mm-hmm. Have you felt that, because DEI, my experience has been that it started primarily around racism and addressing racism. Do you feel like it is also addressing sort of gender identity, sexual orientation, identity issues as well? I mean, what has been your experience with that?
It's mixed, okay, and I'm going to take it from two different perspectives. One is just from the perspective of activities at the university itself. Like, mm-hmm. there's been a lot more racial exposure, you know, if you will. Yep. And but you know, we tend to take it from all angles at the Institute. So mm-hmm. we're really very hyper conscious of it. I also work a lot with our trainees, so our graduate students and postdocs. And I will tell you, so in my work, I submit fellowships for them. And a lot of them are submitting to DEI at, you know, fellowships and, you know, and for the federal government. And unfortunately, I have to walk them through this, right, in terms of what's required, what's needed, and what the eligibility criteria is. And the federal criteria does not recognize LGBTQ as a diversity criteria in these fellowship applications. And I think that's really missing the mark, mm-hmm. you know, and I share that with the trainees, you know, but I'm still required to adhere to the terms and conditions to have their fellowship awarded and reviewed and potentially awarded. And so it's delicate to walk through. Mm-hmm. And we try to find the right fit for them in terms of whether they meet any of the other criteria. So mm-hmm. I think it's a struggle, and it's going to be a struggle for a while. And I think, you know, there's so much happening right now on the political spectrum, like mm-hmm. in other states. Like we hear this at conferences from other research administrators, that like how they're trying to deal with all of these issues in their state, where they live in a state where they're not even allowed to have discussions about DEI. And University of Michigan is like, we're doing it. And I'm so proud of that. Like, they're not caving to any kinds of political pressures, but I think Michigan's gone a little blue in overall. So I think that's a good thing. You know, that was definitely something we talked about before moving here too, and whether that would be a concern for us. And, you know, and we're here because of family, and affordability, frankly. And you know, you live in the Boston area, you know.
Yes.
And but mostly family, and the lifestyle is really nice in the Midwest. I'm not missing Boston traffic, sorry friends. And and it's,
what do you
it's
mean?
Just... I love my 10-minute commute to work, you know, it's not so bad. And you know, but it's just, things are a little neighborly in the Midwest is I think it's a very different approach to things. And I think here in Michigan, it's evolved a lot. It's changed a lot, and people's perspectives have changed a lot. And I think mm-hmm. you have to be in for the long haul with these issues, you know, and there will be setbacks. Mm-hmm. And then just to stay strong through them, I think is really important. Yeah. And to be engaged as much as possible. Yep. I think that's really important.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think, thank you for saying all of that, because it sounds like, you know, here's a university that's trying to do the right thing. Mm-hmm. But, you know, sometimes when you're an organization that has some sort of federal grants and sort of those ties back to federal regulations, it becomes dicey. I remember a situation. I was working for this company that's very, very welcoming, very open, like had, you know, mm-hmm. a LGBTQ ERG, like it was just a really open, and we wanted to do a presentation as the group. And because there was some sort of regulation, because the company was taking federal contracts of some sort, and somehow we're tied to this, we weren't allowed to have the training because it was an LGBTQ type thing. And one of our folks that are running for president was president at the time, and that was a big reason why. You know, I can see sort of that, you know, organizations really have to walk the line between being inclusive and being tied to, you know,
outside agencies and policies. So that's tricky stuff. You know, I follow obviously all the news and everything that's happening in the LGBTQ community. Obviously, I have people in my life that I love that are impacted by these things. You know, it's my opinion that LGBTQ community remains under attack across the globe. Countries are tightening anti-gay laws. Pride events are being warned of terror attacks. States are suing over transgender worker protections, and gay couples are being denied health benefits for IVF. It's just really scary. And it speaks to why we all need to do things like vote, use your voice, address the injustices, to try to make change any way we can. When it comes to social justice, I mean, you've spoken a little bit about it in your work, when it comes to social justice, are there any other LGBTQ related issues that you're pretty passionate about?
So first of all, I want to say that, it's scary now. Like, times are really scary. There's a rise of nationalism and patriotism, and I'm probably mispronouncing that, but that's okay. You get the point. And then a real concerted effort to attack the LGBT community, both abroad and here in the US. And that's been going on for a while now. It's, I almost feel like, there was such a strong movement of feminism, and I'm going to play off of this, that this propelled us into, women's rights, the ability to control your body, voting, credit. I mean, that's only since the 70s. Women can buy houses, women are CEOs, running for president. They're president of some countries, lucky them, there was so much progression in the world that those that don't agree with it, I think, had a lot of fear and couldn't handle it. And now they're desperately trying to claw all of that back. And I would say the best thing I do as a member of the community is to be open. I stand strong. I do not go in the closet. I stand for who I am. Other people be damned. Sorry if that's a swear word on your podcast.
It's not a swear word.
Okay, good. I'm not going to use the other word I thought of. And, yeah.
Okay, good.
I mean, yeah. So, I think it's really important just to be open and not to be afraid, not to live in, like, give in to that fear and go back into hiding. I mean, that's number one. And then to fight for your rights. And there are lots of ways to do that. We certainly support financially different activities and, different organizations. I'm not adverse and have not been adverse at different times to calling up our local politicians and stating my opinions. What you do here in this podcast is supporting, you're doing that in social media. In my social media presence, I share that I'm married. My wife doesn't share because of the line of work that she's in, but that's a whole other conversation. And I have friends that do as well that are in the community. They're very open about it. We're very open about sharing issues or different likes on social medias. I'm a photographer, so I tend to share a lot of nature photos and spread love on social media. And
I've seen them.
Thank you. And do my
very nice
music out on TikTok and other social media platforms. But I think it's really the number one thing you can do is to stay open, and then get involved up to the level of activity that you can support, and even if it makes you uncomfortable, and especially if it makes you uncomfortable, not if it makes you unsafe, there's a difference. Like, if you're uncomfortable about something, it's always good to explore what that is that you're uncomfortable about. That's where growth comes in.
Right.
But if you're feeling unsafe, that's a different story.
Right.
You know?
Right. Yeah. That's important to take care of yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So you're a photographer, you're a fur mama. You are a musician, and I've been seeing you on social, playing your guitar. I think I saw you playing at like a retirement home, or assisted living. I saw it at a farmer's market or something like that. It was like, how cool is that? And I've heard you, so I know how talented you are and how much joy that brings you. Do you participate in any groups or courses or choirs? I know that there's one in your area. It's called the Out Loud Chorus, a member of the gala choruses that are national. There's a bunch of them all over the country. And a lot of the members are from the LGBTQ community. But I didn't know, do you participate in anything like that or?
No, I don't know that I'd have time. But it gave me, it's really a wonderful organization and they've been on campus. So I have seen that. And unfortunately that didn't align with our plans for me to go to their most recent, they performed just a couple of weeks ago. Mm-hmm. But they perform all over the place. And I know, we did partake in a lot of events when we lived in Western Mass. We had more time then. I'm really busy between work and photography and writing and all my other activities. I do perform. Yes, the farmers markets are apparently my gig lately. That's new for me to put myself out there as a musician, and so that's been fun to explore. Mm-hmm. In the assisted living home, I do that with a friend of mine. So we call ourselves, she's treble. We're a duo. And so she plays piano and I sing and play guitar. And it's a wonderful gift. So we were originally going there for her mom. Her mom was a resident there. And then her mom passed. And so we continue to honor her by doing these performances. So I performed Mother's Day and then Father's Day. But I'm thinking about what activities I could possibly do as well. But one thing I am open is when I'm talking with people or, if they're asking me about myself or my life as a musician, even when I'm at the farmers markets, I share openly about being gay and being mm-hmm. married. Mm-hmm. And, and I leave that up to them to, to process. And mm-hmm. I find that most people are welcoming. That's not an issue or concern.
So you said at the end of the previous question, you said there's a difference between feeling uncomfortable and feeling unsafe and mm-hmm. to not participate in things that feel unsafe. We may have some listeners who are unsure or questioning or maybe not feeling supported in their circles. What should they do? I mean, what kind of advice can you give them just from your own sort of experiences?
Well, first of all, I want to say two things. You're not alone and you are loved. And it may not be by the people that you think you should be. And I will say, just from all of my childhood trauma and everything that I had to deal with in terms of my family, the picture can evolve. I have a lot of family in my life and have since I took my journey down the 12 steps, and mainly because that's where I get a lot of support is from my family. And they love me for who I am, but if you're feeling like you need additional support, there are so many organizations out there. They're like a Google search away. There's many mm-hmm. national organizations, GLAAD, PFLAG. I'm going to forget all of the acronyms, but just, do a Google search. You'll find many of them. Many of them have trauma centers. We have friends of ours that they've been married a long time, and they are currently managing their child who is transitioning, and as an LGBTQ family, right? And they're a lesbian couple, and they're trying to figure out and navigate all of this and do it in a way that's healthy for them and for their child. And so it's been really interesting to have them share that with us mm-hmm. as a couple and to watch them experience that. And so, and they too, you know, even though they have been married and been out for a long, long time, they sought help mm-hmm. and needed help in that situation. So, mm-hmm. so, when I say there's a difference between feeling uncomfortable and feeling unsafe, like, you know, there's a lot of unsafe situations, you know, in life and, mm-hmm. you know, and many of them, you know, they require action to get out of. Mm-hmm. And so take an action for yourself and reach out to any one of these organizations, you know, and many are just a Zoom call away even, you know, mm-hmm. which is nice to get a person face to face and safety is first with all of these organizations. So, mm-hmm. you know, and confidentiality. So mm-hmm. they will keep your information confidential until you are ready to reveal it as it should be.
Mm-hmm. One of the organization that we support this time of year and throughout the year, different times of year, is the Trevor Project, because they deal with, you know, the youth suicidality and, you know, and they have so much programming and they have a very tight security system for anyone who might be researching or learning, you know, and in some countries, people can't find this website because it's not allowed. So they do a lot of really wonderful work.
We're interested in travel and we've expressed there are just certain countries we will never travel to. We will never feel safe.
Right.
We don't need to name them all. You can Google those too.
States, and there's many states that aren't safe. So, you know,
sure.
Some of my young people, we are very happy living in the New England states where we are. You know, we live in Massachusetts and we're probably going to move to Connecticut, and it's also a very safe state. So, that's just the reality of mm-hmm. the lifestyle that we need to live.
So. It is. And, you know, my wife and I have chatted that if we ever felt unsafe here, if tides ever turned here in Michigan and we felt unsafe, we would gladly move back to New England, mm-hmm. you know, which would be great. I would get to see all of my peeps more often.
That's right.
So, yes.
Except on, instead of just on Facebook.
Right. For sure.
So great. Anything else you want to add before we wrap it up?
Yeah, I just want to emphasize again, sorry if you hear my dogs barking in the background here. I just wanted to emphasize to anyone, you know, becoming aware or going through or, you know, just again, you're not alone. You're not unloved, you know, and you there are plenty of people to help and there are plenty of resources just you know, a quick text or a phone call away and just reach out. Mm-hmm. You know, and stay safe and stay strong. You know, the world is funny, you know, all of this could be you know, a soundbite a year from now after the election here in the States. We don't know. We hope so. But there are many people now that are really advocating for our progressive movement and, you know, that are wealthy people, which is great because we need a lot of that. And unfortunately, that's what it takes for some of the messaging here. And I would say, you know, do what you can to support those initiatives and activities and as well, you know, any activities in your community as well. So I think that's it. Thank you for having me. This was so much fun.
Yeah. This is all the time we have for today, but, you know, just hearing your story and getting to kind of talk about sort of the reality of the world that we live in. But that there are resources out there, I think was super helpful. So thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you.
And to our listeners, whether you hear us locally from the BTV studios in Bedford, Massachusetts, or across the globe on such podcast channels as Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or Amazon Prime, thanks for listening. We hope you enjoyed this episode, and we'll see you next time. Happy storytelling!